مهمان من بیشتر عمرش را صرف آموزش کودکان و به خصوص آموزش دختران در منطقه از پاکستان کرده و می کند که برداشت‌های عقب‌گرایانه از دین، سنت‌های سمج و نفوذ طالبان دختران را عملاً از آموزش محروم می کند. ولی ضیاءالدین یوسفزای همه خطرات و تهدیدهای طالبان را به جان خرید و در منطقه سوات پاکستان برای دختران مدرسه دایر کرد و با کودکان از برابری دختر و پسر گفت. طالبان هم تهدیدشان را عملی کردند و روزی یکی از مامورانشان وارد مینیبوس مدرسه دخترش ملاله شد، او را با نام صدا زد و چند گلوله به مغزش خالی کرد. ملاله جان به در برد و به خاطر تلاش‌هایش برای آموزش دختران جایزه صلح نوبل گرفت. ضیاءالدین یوسفزای امروز یکی از بنیانگذاران بنیاد ملاله است و همچنان در آموزش دختران فعال است. ایده آموزش دختران در این منطقه به شدت سنتی و زیر نفوذ طالبان چگونه در ذهن مهمان من نشست و چگونه به دخترش ملاله منتقل شد؟ Ziauddin Yousofzai, welcome to Ebarat-e Digar.
Thank you so much.
You grew up in a traditional family in Swat Valley. Your parents were very traditional. They were dead against the girls' education. Your five sisters never went to school. And yet you rebelled and you opened a girls' school in that part of the world. How come?
Thank you so much. Yes, you're right. I grew up in a community which was purely patriarchal. I grew up in a family of five sisters, and none of my sisters could go to school. There were two reasons. Number one, there were not enough opportunities for the girls' education. And number two, my parents, they were not keen about their education. So my parents had big, tall dreams for me, being a boy. And the only dream they had for my sisters were to marry them as early as possible. And I often tell that if I had been one of my five sisters, or if I had been a sixth daughter to my family, the world would have never heard of me. So that was the kind of social environment, social, like it was not a norm to send a girl to school. What did change me to be a different father? It was education. Education transformed me into the kind of person that I am. Education taught me to believe in equality of a girl and a boy, and education taught me that the most powerful weapon of change is education. Because I saw change in my own personality because of education. That made me beautiful. My inner being became beautiful of education. Mm-hmm. And that credit goes to my father. Right. Because he believed so much in my education. Mm-hmm. He taught me Arabic, Persian, and Islamic education. And he sent me to a very good school. He was a teacher himself. So I appreciate him so much for educating me, though I can't appreciate him for not educating his daughters. Mm-hmm. But that was the kind of environment, the social norms. It was not a social norm to send a girl to school.
Yes. I mean, you said that was through the education that you realized that the importance of educating girls. But how the idea of equality came to your mind? Because that wasn't something that was widespread there. I mean, this is something that, as you described your parents, there was a huge difference between the boys and the girls in the family.
Yes, of course. Like I myself observed and I myself experienced inequality and discrimination due to other reasons. Like I was not a handsome boy in the classroom, and some of the teachers did not like me that much, as they were more inclined towards the handsome boys. that was a color discrimination, you can say, or appearance discrimination. I also belong to the lower middle class, like a poor family. My father was a teacher, and I could see that the teachers were, some of the teachers, not all, I will not blame all of them, some of them were taking more care of the rich family boys. So I was, right from the very beginning, I was very mindful and conscious towards inequality and discrimination. And when I could see in the family that my five sisters, like they are not treated equally with the boys, like in small things, but they were big in a way, like in food, a good part of food was given to the men and the leftover, or the poor part of the food was given to the female, in clothing, even in daily conversation, like nicer talk to boys and not very nice talk to the girls, sometimes very rude to them. So that was the kind of environment that I experienced, that and I could see that inequality in every way. And the worst discrimination or the worst inequality that my sisters and other girls of the community went through, that the boys, I mean, they were sent to school and the girls were not. And that made our lives different. And I always tell people that in patriarchal societies, girls and women, they die as they were never born. Like education, when you send them to school, you give them life, mm-hmm. you give them identity, yeah. you give them recognition. When they step into a school and a classroom, mm-hmm. the teacher write their name. From there, the journey starts. The journey of self-being, the journey of to be themselves, the journey of their own identity. Mm-hmm. And that's why I'm a staunch and great believer of education, that if we want emancipation, freedom, and self-independence for our girls, we must send them to school.
So what did you do exactly when you came to this kind of understanding? So what was the first step?
The first step was that when I completed my education, I started school. Mm-hmm. And it was both for girls and boys. Mm-hmm. And this was not the first ever school in the community. There were like hundreds of other schools as well. But the specialty of my school was the kind of curriculum and the kind of environment I created, that I encourage girls to be disobedient if it comes to be respectfully disobedient, mm-hmm. if it comes to their basic rights. Like if their parents want to marry them early or force them to marry somebody, they should stand up for their rights. And I taught the boys that they should be good boys. Mm-hmm. They should believe inequality both for girls and boys. So my school was different in a way that mm-hmm. it was like a social platform for change. I used to invite parents, mothers and fathers, and the community, like the parents were also the part of education. And I used to do workshop and seminars to educate them about the importance of girls' education, about the harms of early child marriages. So my school was a different school in that way.
Yeah. And how did your family reacted to this?
My family, like this was, they were comfortable with it, but like my giving too much importance to my daughter, mm-hmm. Some of them were not very comfortable. Like I'll tell a story that when, for the first time, when my daughter was born and few weeks after, my cousin came and coincidentally, he brought the family tree. And he showed me and he presented me a gift of the family tree, mm-hmm. That this is your copy. Mm-hmm. And when I looked at the family tree and I saw they were all men, fathers, forefathers, grandfathers, great-grandfathers.
No mention of any
No
female.
Mention of a woman. Mm-hmm. And you see a woman is, in reality, she's the family.
Yeah, of course.
And when I saw it, I just picked up my pen and I drew a line from my name and I wrote Malala. And when my cousin looked at that action, mm-hmm. so he was very, he has this grimace on his face. And he was staring towards me that, look at this crazy man. Mm-hmm. He's putting a girl name on a family tree. But mm-hmm. I just smiled and mm-hmm. I meant it. Mm-hmm. Similarly, later on when Malala grew up And she became very active in her educational activities and also standing against Taliban and speaking. My nephew, he told to my wife that this girl is now quite grown up. And people in community, they talk ill about it, that mm-hmm. she should not be on screen, she should hide, she should be inside the four walls, like not, she should not be visible. Mm-hmm. My wife told me, and I told my wife, tell him that he should not poke his nose in our family affairs. So that right. was the kind of things that yeah. In the beginning I saw. Yeah. But I tell people that in patriarchy, or whenever you stand for a change, or whenever you stand against the social taboos, so the first person you come across is you, because you are the part of that community. It is difficult for you to take a different course of life. Mm-hmm. It's easy to flow with the tide of the river, mm-hmm. but it's very it's quite comfortable. You feel comfortable when you go with the flow of water.
That's right.
But to
go against it,
to go against yeah. it is quite difficult.
Yeah. Well, and no, you mentioned that. I mean, you said about your reaction from your family, but what about the community? I mean, you were teaching the girls to be rebellious.
To be honest, the community in yeah. Swat, they are very liberal, progressive. Mm-hmm. Before Talibanization, we had a great valley, mm-hmm. like in the Swat Valley. Swat was merged in Pakistan in 1969. So Swat was a princely state from 1917 to 1969. And we had a great infrastructures of schools, colleges, and health. So when Taliban banned girls' education, you can just guess from this mm-hmm. Statistic that more than 50,000 girls were stopped from being going to school.
Yeah.
That means that people believed in girls' education. Mm-hmm. We were living in a paradise-like valley of Swat,
yeah.
which was a center of tourism, not terrorism. Mm. All this came after Talibanization.
Mm-hmm. I know that Malala, your daughter, was very active in those days when you opened the school and encouraged girls to come for education and all that. But what Malala exactly was doing there?
Good. This is a good question. Like, she was a normal student in the Swat Valley. She was like all other girls. She was going to school in the morning. She was very fond of her school. Because she knew that her aunts on either side, from maternal side, paternal side, they could not achieve education. So education was so important, and she was so keen. She was such a good student. Right when she was like very, very small, very young, like a nursery and a kindergarten class, she used to wash her scarf and her socks every day to be clean, neat, and tidy. So she was a normal girl, a normal student of a school. And education was like a normal thing. And then in 2005-06, this Talibanization started in the Swat Valley. They started from their FM radio. Mm. They started speaking against girls' education, that it is prohibited in Islam. Later on, in 2007, they also started burning and destroying schools, and they destroyed more than 400 schools. So that was the time, from 2007 onward, when Malala stood up for the right of education. And she did the BBC blog when Taliban completely banned girls' education, and they had bombed many, many schools. So at that time, she wrote a blog for BBC. She volunteered herself and me myself as well for the New York Times documentaries. And she spoke to every platform where she could go, to every seminar, and she toured the country that what is happening in Swat, it is against human rights. Education is right, and it's education is a right of a girl and a boy both. And we should be educated. And that message was so powerful mm-hmm. that after the military operation in Swat, we became IDPs as well, like internally displaced. for 3 months. And when the military operation was done and Taliban fled from the area, they left Swat Valley and we went back to Swat. After that, she started like her campaign for education, not against just Taliban, but she could see many girls and boys who were in streets. Many were involved and suffering because of the domestic child labor. So then she was thinking to have an organization, to have her activism. Mm-hmm. And that was the reason that her voice spread like a crescendo in the whole country.
Yeah.
And this one girl's voice was so powerful that Taliban thought that it's a risk, it's a threat to their ideology because they don't believe in girls' education. Yeah. They don't believe in women's empowerment.
Yeah.
And that's why.
But that was during that time that you were going against the teaching or preaching of Taliban, and you carried on with the educating girls, you were threatened by Taliban.
Yeah, of course. Like,
what did they say?
Malala was a normal student and I was a normal teacher.
Yeah.
When this basic right of education was taken away by Taliban, we turned from teacher and student into rebellious education campaigners that no, we don't accept this. And that was the kind of environment where we had to speak. So I spoke and she spoke. And you asked about, like, what did they do?
No, I mean, they threatened you.
They threatened me on their FM. They also issued a threatening note in the newspapers and to the media against my daughter. After that, really, it was very difficult days for our family. Because the threat, when we received it, when you are in a conflict area and the militants are strong and they threaten you, it is so difficult to cope with.
Mm-mm. So when they actually shot Malala in the school bus, they called her name and then when identified her and then shot her, when you heard the news, did you feel guilty at all?
That day I was in the press club in Swat and I was about to give my speech because I was the president of the private school association and it was midday. And my friend told me that the school bus has been attacked. So I didn't know that who has been attacked, but I only knew and I had different thoughts. But later on when I knew that yes, the school bus has been attacked and my daughter and two other girls have been attacked and they have shot. It was the most difficult time in our life.
Reason I asked because you felt guilty or not.
It was become like a black hole. And whatever happens in my life, especially whatever bad happens in life to our family, the first person I ask is myself, that what was my part?
Yeah.
And really, I was thinking for some time that if I could have stopped her not to speak, if we could have left the Swat Valley for some time. But I did try to leave the valley and to get her out of the valley, but it was not working, to be honest. I underestimated or miscalculated the threat of Taliban, and I thought people told me also, my near friends used to tell me that no, we are Pashtuns, and Pashtuns, it's their tradition that they never go for a girl and for a child. So she's a girl and she's a child, even if you have heard something bad, it will never happen. But it happened.
Yeah.
They had no ethics at all. I had this kind of thinking and self-accountability going on in my subconscious, and then I asked my wife, that what do you think, who is responsible? And she told me a very important thing at that very difficult time. She told me, look, neither you nor anybody else should feel guilty because you stood for the basic right of education and peace, and she stood for that right. You did not compel her. She was speaking from herself.
Yeah.
And guilty should be the people who have attacked her. And I'm such, I believe in the wisdom of my wife. Even when I go out of my home, I don't look in a mirror. I just stand in front of her and I say, am I right? She says, well, you look great. And then I go out. So after that, I didn't think much about it. But I'll tell you very important thing. Like, she is unstoppable. And she was unstoppable.
Yeah.
If she could not be silenced by Taliban heinous attack, I think she started speaking again when in 2012, 9 October, she was attacked. And after a few months, after 6-7 months, she went to UN and she just stood there on the podium. And then she said, one pen, one teacher, one child, and one book can change the world. I think that was a crucial time that she could decide that, look, I did a lot. Let me have my life and quiet time. But she is, it is in her DNA. Like activism in her DNA.
I think that even if I had tried, I wouldn't
have stopped her. She's unstoppable.
We would have loved to have Malala here and talk to her. And I know that she's busy with her
that
education
might happen
at
one
the moment.
Day.
Yeah, but definitely, yeah, we love to have her here and her her story, basically, directly. So ever since the Malala was shot, I mean, your status, your it's changed drastically. I mean, from a teacher in Swat Valley, you become a globally known. You lecture, you go various places. You've been to many countries. You've written book and all that. And one can ask this question: whether it was you who made Malala, or Malala made you?
It didn't happen either way.
Mm-hmm.
Neither I made her nor she made me.
Mm-hmm.
I wrote two books before I came to the UK.
Yeah.
Both were in my own mother tongue. Mm-hmm. One was in poetry, one was in prose. I was a well-known human rights activist, peace activist, education campaigner in the Swat Valley. I loved my life in Swat. Because that was my first choice.
Mm-hmm.
That was the kind of life I chose for myself and for my family. And I told you earlier that we were living in the paradise-like Valley of Swat. That every night I dream that I am there. So that is not the case that she made me or I made her. The only thing I did, and I tell people, they don't ask me what I did, ask me what I did not do.
Mm-hmm.
I did not clip her wings. I just believed in her that, yes, she is an individual, she is a girl, and she has equal rights like a boy. And I believed in the power of education. That's my role in her life. She is she. She is herself something that she is like the kind of person. For the first time when she was born, and I saw her as a like newborn baby, believe me, her eyes were open and shining like stars. And at that very moment, I felt that I am the most blessed person on this earth. So I did not make her. And I will say that she didn't make me as well, because I had a great life in the Swat Valley, though our objective conditions changed. Once she was speaking for more than 50,000 or 60,000 girls when education was banned for girls in the Swat Valley. And now she is speaking for 130 million girls all around the world who are not in school.
Mm-hmm.
Once I was working happily with great pleasure in this Swat, in that valley for girls' education and for boys' education. And now I am spreading this message of equality in girls' education all around the world. So I think that is the change in our platform is because of the incident. But I must tell one thing for sure, that even if that attack had not happened, it might have taken few more years, like maybe 7-8 years, but Malala would have still been a global figure.
Yeah.
Because the kind of guts and the kind of passion that she had, I could see that.
Yeah.
And she was attacked because she was well known in every corner of the world,
yeah.
in every part of the of her home country. And that is why Taliban, in spite of having these suicide attackers and bombs and Kalashnikovs, they were scared of that one girl with a book.
Right. Do you keep in touch with the Swat Valley? I mean, you know that you've been back there, but what's the current situation of the girls' education in Swat Valley?
The current situation is very good.
Yeah.
There are hundreds and thousands of girls that are going to school.
Yeah.
Peace has been restored after 2009. And we went to Swat last year in March. Mm-hmm. It was the most exciting and very emotional moment of our life when we went back to the Swat Valley. And we landed on the same helipad where from Malala was lifted when she got injured, seriously injured. So having this wholeness of family all together in Swat, going back to our home and just touching the soil of our home and house, looking and seeing the rooms and her trophies in the same house, it was such an emotional moment in our life. And Swat Valley is really, there is a very good peace now. Girls are going to school and people are enjoying their life. And even tourists have started going back to the Swat. Yeah.
All right. We haven't got much time, so I've got one more question.
I speak for long,
that is, as we said, you've been to various parts of the world through the Malala Foundations. You've been very active. You actually co-founder of the Malala Foundation. But you have never been to Afghanistan, whereas the Afghan situation is very much similar to what it was during the time that the Taliban were at Swat Valley, and all the problem that you were facing there, and more or less in the various parts, they have the same problem. And is it closest to you?
Strategically, as our organization is concerned, strategically, Afghanistan is the most important country for our work. And we met the president of Afghanistan. Two times we met the First Lady of Afghanistan, two times, and we are working in Afghanistan. Mm-hmm. We have started for the last 3 years, we have this Gulmakai network. Gulmakai was Malala's pen name when she was writing the BBC blog, and under that name, we have formed this network in many countries, and Afghanistan is one of them. Mm-hmm. We have Gulmakai network in Afghanistan, India, for Syrian region, and many other countries. But in Afghanistan, our Gulmakai champions are very smart, and they are working with the government departments, with the community to enhance girls' education. One of the organization is training female teachers, because you know that is quite conservative society, and parents don't want to send their girls to school where men teach. Mm-hmm. So we have trained many female teachers there, that is the kind of link between Malala and Malala of Afghanistan, because you may know that I named Malala after the Malala of Mewand, who was legendary Afghan heroine who raised her voice for freedom in the Second Anglo-Afghan War and encouraged the fighters to go back and to fight. So she is such an important figure. So I'm very much inspired from the history of Afghanistan, and definitely we will go to Afghanistan one day because it deserves our support. It deserves world support. That country should stand on its own feet, because its education, its peace is very important for the whole world, and especially for the region, for Pakistan and your country and India and that region. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Ziauddin Yousofzai. Thank you for being my guest.
Thank you for having me here.
Thank you.